interested in it, Uncle. Often Hindus often get asked, why do we worship animal gods and goddesses? Now, I know in some of your previous talks you've mentioned we have a very close link with the animal kingdom. I'm wondering if there's a more mature reason for this, and if so, why do we still do it?
Yes, in fact, the reason why animals get intertwined in our narrative or in our colorful storytelling is because since ancient times we have recognized, if you like, that we are a continuation of the animal kingdom. We are not something apart from the animal kingdom. In fact, a lot of these attributes the animals possess are still very amiable, they're very nice. So in a way, by invoking the animals within our system, with our gods and goddesses, we are in a way saying that some of the aspects are very endearing, very likable about animals. So that is why they get incorporated. But the main thing is this. This is why we are a very mature religion. We've been thinking about this thing for many years, thousands of years, and we know. So what Darwin discovered recently is very new stuff for them, but for us it's very ancient stuff, that we are the continuation of the animal kingdom. So the respect you show for life cannot be restricted just to the humankind, it must be extended into the animal kingdom. That is why, you see, with all the gods and goddesses, they'll have a vehicle. So in a way, kind of giving them, elevating the state of animals, linking them with the gods and goddesses. So if it's Saraswati, it'll be a swan. If it is Vishnu, it'll be an eagle. So we are in a way uplifting the animal kingdom and in a way giving them more reverence. So reverence for life is the main idea. That is why the idea of ahimsa, that is why it says some Hindus will be not only vegetarian, they'll be vegan even. So this is why we kind of recognize divinity of all living, in the whole living kingdom. And that is why, in a nice, colorful manner, we have incorporated these animal features in our storytelling. So like the vehicles of the gods and goddesses, or sometimes even the faces, you know, like Ganesh, elephant head. So anyway, incorporating the idea that human and animal are not that different, they're intertwined. So in a way, this is why we, in a way, it's a very mature religion, recognizing the importance of the whole living kingdom, not just the human kingdom. And the modern world that we live in is also recognizing it and saying you must now, you know, be less cruel to the animal kingdom, must be take great care of the animal welfare situation. So the world is beginning to recognize this. And I'm also quite confident that within 50 years, the world will turn vegetarian.
Yeah.
I'm quite confident. It's not because Hindus are saying so. When I go to a lot of English schools, lots of English girls' schools especially, sometimes 20% of the girls are vegetarian. They tell their mom, no meat for me. You know, make vegetables or whatever, lasagna or whatever, but no meat. So now I'm finding, I've just went to a Swakli girls' school, and they were vibrant. And when I present some of the ideas of Hinduism, they were kind of jumped about and become my, you know, like, you know, groupies. You know? So they really fall in love with Hinduism because of this idea of reverence for life. So it's not a minor thing. And many other people criticize Hindu, saying, oh, you got animal-headed gods and animal features in your religions, you're worshipping. It's such a nasty thing to say. We are saying, give reverence to the whole animal kingdom.
So Ditabai, something that doesn't sit very comfortably for me within Hinduism is sort of sacrifice of animals, like the Ashwamedha, you know, in history we have, you know, recollections of this. Could you perhaps expand on that? I know in other religions, you know, for instance, in the Bible, there are mention of animal sacrifices. Even now, I think in India, you know, they do have, you know, ceremonies where they sacrifice goats, etc. Could you expand on that a bit more and explain the meaning or the reason for that?
You see, we have to recognize the historicity of Hinduism in its true light. We mustn't cut corners and say, no, we never had animal sacrifice. It's not true. In fact, in the story of Buddha, you see this marvelous example. Buddha was walking out and he saw hundreds of animals being driven to a king's court. He said, why are these animals being driven to the king's court? They said, don't you know there's a yagna taking place and all these animals are going to be sacrificed. Buddha is sacrificing animals? What kind of religion is this? So he went to the king. This is a lovely story. I'm sure it's a historic story. It's not just made up. And he told the king, if you sacrifice, how many animals do you want to sacrifice? 1,000 animals? The king said, yes. The more animals we sacrifice, they go to higher heaven. And then Buddha said, look, in that case, forget about the animals. Suppose you sacrifice me, you go to even higher heaven. I'm human. And the king was shuddered. He said, what is he saying? But in two ticks, he managed to put across the message of reverence for life. And killing animals or sacrificing animals to appease a god in heaven is nonsense. How can God be satisfied when you're murdering his creation? So it is an outdated practice. But we must recognize that it used to happen in ancient India. We shouldn't say, oh no, it never happened. And even the Ashwamedha Yagna, we thought it's lovely and colorful, and you know, we got this Ram doing the Ashwamedha Yagna, and the horse is sent off, you know, to go into different kingdoms, and they meet love and all this lovely, colorful story. But the real Ashwamedha Yagna was animal sacrifice. It was horse sacrifice. And they used to sacrifice the horse and eat the meat as prasad. Frightening, doesn't it make you shudder? Best to recognize it. We too, like many other religions, in the initial stages we thought the best way to appease some higher powers, gods and goddesses in the heaven, the forces of nature, was to try and give them something, offer them something. So you do some business with gods and goddesses. And the best way to do business, they decided, would be to sacrifice animal life. You know, in all religions, it's visible in every religion. They would sacrifice animal life to appease the higher powers. It is a very, if you like, very antique idea of how to deal with reality. In order to control the forces of nature, oh, let us do some business with the gods and all the forces of nature, Varun and Indra and all that, and offer them, you know, sacrifices. Animals, life, let's give them life, it's so precious. So let's give life to them. That is how it started. We have gone through that phase, like all other religions, you know, in the Abrahamic tradition, everyone's prepared to sacrifice his son. So it is visible in every religion, including the Inca religion, everywhere visible that you are sacrificing life to appease higher forces. But as humanity evolved, including the Hindus, this idea of animal sacrifice has been put on the back burner. But there may be some tribes, some cults, etc. in India that continue the practice. It is not something that the mainstream Hindus subscribe to anymore, thankfully. So instead of sacrificing animals, do you know what they do? They sacrifice a coconut. They, you know, crack a coconut. That's the whole idea behind it. So it is, we have evolved. We recognize that just killing animals or taking life cannot really please any gods or goddesses. So it was an antiquated idea, and we had it. Best to recognize it rather than say, oh no, we never did it. And recognize it and deal with it and grow out of it. This is what evolution is about. We learn through lessons, and then we evolve and become better. So now, coconuts. Maybe we'll give up the coconuts as well in days to come.
Dilip Bhai, in Hinduism, we've had many prophets or God-realized persons, but in other traditions, in major world religions, we see there's only been one prophet, and they are stuck to that. And I think now the problems we are having in this world now, I think they need a new prophet that can guide them to a better understanding of their religion in a way.
You see, let me lighten up a little bit. At one Christian meeting, there were a lot of Christian ministers, and they were quizzing me. They said, how come you produce so many God-realized people, almost every century produces one giant? And you know why? They keep coming again and again. Why? I said, very simple reason, I said. I'm lightening up. I said, God likes to come down to earth and play with humanity from time to time, interact with humanity. You know, yada yada hi dharma. He likes to come down from quite often. And he used to come, and once in a while, he decided to be born in the Middle East. He was born as Christ. And what did you do to him? You nailed him to the cross. Since that time, he decided, I can't risk it. It's best to be born in India, where the people play drums and beat drums. We love his God. He's born outside, they knock him out. You murder him. This is terrible. I said, this is why. He doesn't want to risk it. So this is a light-hearted answer. But look, this is true. You see, this is the biggest problem we face in the modern world is because religion and the secular worldview or the science worldview cannot sit together. Because most of the Western philosophy, Western thinking on religion comes from Christianity, which is in a way stuck in a rut because the main prophet lived about 2,000 years ago. And because he lived 2,000 years ago, the message he left was only suitable perhaps for his own time. But unfortunately, we live in a modern world where the universe has moved on, humanity has evolved dramatically, we've got new science and new ideas about regarding reality, but the ancient teachings continue to be kind of, you know, stuck with the ancient teachings of the Bible. And of course, science will knock it out. Say, six-day creation, what rubbish. Adam and Eve is a special creation, a special, you know, kind of product of, you know, God's world. That's not true. If we are coming out of the animal kingdom. Adam and Eve were not special. And yet they can't respond because as Manish Pai mentioned, they have not produced more recent prophets of the same caliber as Christ. So they are stuck in a rut. So he's saying that will they produce a modern prophet who can then take, if you like, the teachings of Christianity and other religions into this particular modern phase? The answer is yes. That's why I'm very pleased you asked this question. And do you know who that prophet is? He's not yet to come because, Yehovah is coming. I'm not talking like that. The prophet was there. And do you know who the prophet is and who's going to be again central stage in the West? Vivekananda. First time India has produced a prophet, not just fit to respond to the requirements of the Indian subcontinent, but for the whole world. His message is so universal and it is so potent that within 10 years' time, not going to wait till 50 years, within 10 years' time, this message will become visible in the Western world, in the modern world, and it will become universal. So the prophet India has produced recently is no longer fit for just Indian subcontinent. That's why Vivekananda's talks were not given mostly in India, they were given in the West, in English. Because this message of, if you like, much more modern vision of religion, much more contemporary vision of religion, much more sensible and much more rational vision of religion was represented by Vivekananda in the West. So that if he's saying, will a prophet be born in the West, as he's already come and gone, his message has not still entered the Western society, but people like me are rolling up our sleeves and making sure it enters Western society. And it's a very dramatic message. You know why it's dramatic? It reconciles a variety of multitude of religious worldviews, which nobody else could do. No, the prophet has done it. It then recognizes the importance of shifting our emphasis not on a God in the heaven, but God in humanity. This is modern religion. Majority of youngsters today don't believe in a God in heaven. It's gone. Sell by date is gone. When you talk about something special about humanity, that is showing itself through this human form, they relate to it very well. And where does this message come from? From this modern proponent of religion, modern proponent of spirituality, this Vivekananda is a prophet not for India, but for the whole world, including the West.
My question is regarding a contradiction that I've come across. So the Upanishads state, Tattvam Asi, you are that. I think they also state, Aham Brahmasmi, we are this vast spiritual reality. Even Swami Vivekananda himself says, manifest the divinity within. So it's quite obvious that we are, from what they're saying, that we are God, this God concept. We are the highest truth. But then I think they also say, and I've heard or I've read things from other self-realized persons, enlightened persons, they say we have forgotten who we are. You know, our essential nature is bliss. So then, if you want to generalize it a bit more, so we are God, yet we forget who we are. Does God forget?
You see, first of all, let me congratulate Vijay for touching base with esoteric Hinduism, the high philosophy Hinduism, the Upanishadic Hinduism, not the narrative, the colorful storytelling and Puran, all that, is gone past it. It's focused on the Upanishads. And the teachings of the Upanishad, the Mahavakyas, these are called the Mahavakyas, Aham Brahmasmi, these are powerful thoughts right at the heart of Hinduism. So he's saying that if we are essentially the spirit, all pure and pristine, why are we messing around here? We forget what we are? Why or why? Now you see, this is a very important question. And the answer is this. This is real. I'm not exaggerating, I'm not making it up. Really, it doesn't have an answer. You say, well, this is terrible. You know, the most central question, you say, there's no answer. You see, the reason is this. This is what we are suggesting. We are saying why this ultimate reality, this principle called Brahman, takes on all these forms, takes a manifestation as galaxies, then appears as little creatures in there, little animals, insects, and becoming human. Why does it take on this journey? Because it's forgotten its true nature. Why or why does it do it? And how can it forget its real nature? Why this journey takes place is something that has never been answered by any Hindu philosopher so far. Guaranteed, including Vivekananda. In fact, he says the answer, the question will remain unanswerable, not because we don't want to answer you, but this the reason because you feel, it's such an important question, I must answer, get an answer to it. The answer doesn't lie with this kind of intellectual gymnastics, the answer lies in experience. When you know you are a spirit, I'm telling you from experience, when you know you are a spirit, the question appears irrelevant. The fact that I had forgotten seems to be, it doesn't matter. It was like a dream, it was like an appearance. I seem to have kind of, lost track of my true nature, but that too was an appearance. It was never reality. This is the answer. This may sound, you are still fobbing us off. You are just kind of, it's a cop-out. It's not a real answer. The answer lies in actual experience of the spirit. If you just assert, I'm Brahman, it's not going to help you. It's only when you experience Brahman, when you experience your true nature as Brahman, that a resolution to this question appears. Let me create a bit of humor. Just deliberately, it's a very subtle question. The humor is this. There was one man used to, every night, dream and get into a nightmare. And the nightmare was frightening. So he went to a psychiatrist and said, I've got a problem. Every night I sleep and I get a nightmare. Psychiatrist, what was the nightmare? He said, the nightmare was basically, I see a door. And I push and I push. I want to go through and I push and I push and I push. And the door doesn't open. And I break out into a sweat. It's a nightmare. I want to get through. I'm convinced I must get through. And I just can't get through. So it's a nightmare. I keep pushing and pushing and I just can't get through. And I sweat and I get up. Psychiatrist says, oh, this is terrible. Okay, again tomorrow, tell me what is your experience. Come back. Again he came back. He said, same problem. Sweating, pushing, push, push. Door won't open. And it's a nightmare for me. The third night, he again went. He went back to the psychiatrist. Same problem. I'm sweating. The psychiatrist, what else did you observe? He said, I was observing the door. You know, the door, it said, pull. You see, you answered your own question. You see, now, you see, this question I'm trying to lighten up is a very serious thing. So because you think the question is so burning, and you are sweating, why have I forgotten I am the spirit? Why have I forgotten? When you actually experience with the spirit, the question appears irrelevant. Just like that man is, oh, I didn't really, it's just a pull, simple as that. So the moment you experience yourself as a spirit, the question falls apart. I'm telling you, every enlightened person, whether it's Vivekananda or Ramakrishna, will tell you the same answer. But with Ramakrishna, they'll say, go and ask Mother Goddess, why this suffering and why creation, why are we all this in a mess? He would go there, and the moment you see her, go, oh, mommy, and then come back. He said, what did you? He said, I couldn't ask the question. When I saw it, there was no question. The question dropped off. It's not a make-believe. It's not just artificial. Actually, the question becomes irrelevant when you come face-to-face with the reality. The question, the burning question loses all its relevance and drops off. But now, does it mean the question is bad? No. The fact that you keep asking this question is a sign of stirring up. You are no longer happy or comfortable with your own state. You say, why am I forgetting I am the spirit? Why? How dare it? So this question, the burning question, is going to lead you to the spiritual experience. So the question is not bad. And the answer lies in you finding out who you are, and then you'll see why the question is not relevant. Until then, let it burn you. So you'll keep pushing the door. But one day you'll pull it, and then you'll be okay.
So my next question is around enlightened persons, realized persons. So there are many people in the past, and there are many people now, in the present, who claim self-realization, who claim to be enlightened. These are so-called godmen. Okay, and some of these individuals are extremely intelligent, they are highly charismatic, and people are naturally attracted towards them. But then, how can we be so sure if these people are genuine or not? It's very easy to get caught up in what they're talking about and, you know, caught up in them. So how do we know that they are actually self-realized and not self-deluded?
You see, the fact that you are asking the question itself is a good sign. Because majority of humanity is easily bought out by the external razzmatazz. So you see the huge institutions, 100,000 people applauding and clapping hands and beating drums and calling him, Bhagwan Reshya, like this. This is natural in India. It's visible everywhere. And there are so many of them. And the normal human mind is gullible. Especially in India, we are gullible to religious ideas. Anything given to you in the name of religion, you'll swallow it without any hesitation. This is our problem. Because religion has been a central feature of this nation for thousands of years, it has entered our system. So if anything comes to you and says, this is in the name of religion, you mustn't do that. You mustn't eat on this day, or you mustn't eat this after 6 p.m. You will say, oh, so religion, okay. You immediately swallow it without thinking for yourself. So majority of humanity easily is kind of misguided. And because Hinduism is an open system, it is open to abuse, and it's very serious abuse. So what happens to this? there are individuals, you can make out straight away, that they are, you know, mostly kind of out there for their own purposes. They're out for their own pocket. So they sell themselves as gurus or teachers, and their intention is basically to try and get your money and get your devotion, make you sit at their feet. Hundreds of them in India at the moment. It's a sad thing. Because we have an open system, all of these can jump on the bandwagon and take it for a ride. And they are doing tremendous harm to Hinduism, but they are doing it, they are there. There are this whole one bunch of people who are actually out to delude us, charlatans. There is a large batch. In fact, we'll talk about it. The second batch of people we find also in the system are those people who are self-deluded. So just because they memorize the Bhagavad Gita and they know all these slokas and they can do Sanskrit, you know, karokar, they feel they are the masters, or perhaps they are very good storytellers, you know, Puranis. It goes into a head that they are spiritual masters because they can do the story of this and that and make everybody cry and laugh and dance. See how they are clever they are. These are people who are self-deluded. Now the question is very pointed. How do you tell them apart? Whether they are out to delude you, whether they are self-deluded, and how do you know how to distinguish them, and how do you, you know, avoid them or not get caught in their grips? Very powerful question. It depends on the individual. If, for example, your level of understanding is very superficial, or your real take on religion is very superficial, then you'll be satisfied with a superficial teacher. You find your level. Suppose I'm interested in a big institution, then only I feel this is real. Then I'm going to get caught up by one of the big institutions and become a member of that. Good luck to me. Now, I'll just give you the example of real masters. Look, my mentor Vivekananda and his mentor, his teacher Ramakrishna. Just give you the true story. In the time of Sri Ramakrishna, apart from a dozen youngsters, 16 to 18 year old youngsters who were just wandering around and, you know, chatting with him all the time, the majority of people in Calcutta could not be bothered. They did not recognize the you know, vitality of this personality, the power of this person. They couldn't come recognize it at all. At that time, there was Kesho Chandra Sen, head of Brahmo Samaj in Calcutta. And 5,000 people will, you know, go for his meetings and listen to his very brilliant lectures, very academic lectures, saying, wow, this is the real spiritual giant. And that Ramakrishna was unknown. What about his disciple Vivekananda? He was a master, God-realized personality, wandering around India as a penniless monk who wasn't sure where his next meal is coming from. Do you think the Indian people recognized the mastery of this gentleman? Nothing. Zero. He didn't do a single public talk in India while he was wandering around. He was not recognized at all. Only when he went to the United States, and there he, you know, beat the drum of Hinduism at the Parliament of Religion, and when the West said, wait, this guy, how can we convert people from this nation? They are more learned than us. We should sit at their feet and learn about religion. This one man, because he was able to kind of touch the, you know, foundation of the Western civilization, they recognized his validity and gave him credentials. And only when the West gave credentials to Vivekananda, India got, he's the son of the Mother India. Let's welcome him back and listen to him, and he must teach us what to do. Until they did not recognize him. Why? You see, this is the reason. They are easily fobbed off by the externals and could not go look at the depth of the spiritual experience or the potency of that in personality. And it's the same today. It's not changed anymore. That is why you got all these, you know, I shouldn't say this, but there are so many charlatans in the system stealing, if you like, money from very poor people whose devotions you can see in their eyes. They are devout. And what little savings they have, they'll grab it. Give me all your money, I'll solve your problems. All your health problem, wealth problem, I will sort it out. Just give me your money. Do you think the problems are sorted? They get even poorer. And they are taken for a ride. And their love for their religion is also destroyed forever because they have been cheated. So this is the answer is this. Really, how do you know? This is how I know. Look, this is my personal trick. A person who has experienced God or spirit will never fall back on antiquated scriptures or ancient scriptures. He will produce new scripture, will make you thrill, will give you a thrill of your life. They never fall back on ancient. They produce modern version of spirituality. In fact, it is much more dramatic and vibrant than the ancient ones. And how is it? Because when you listen to them, you know these personalities are talking of religion and from their first and next. In fact, when I was in search myself, I could not be bought out by any of these external razzmatazz or any sectarian movement. None of them would attract me at all because I could see through them. There's no experience there. It's just book learning and rituals and building temples. And they couldn't attract me. I wasn't bothered. I was looking for the serious masters who were actually talking about religion or spirit, about God, from first encounter. There are quite a few, like Ramana Maharshi, Ramakrishna, Ramdas, you know, Ramatirtha. They are lovely. In the last century, we produced half a dozen. Anandamayi, you see, these are giants, spiritual giants. Because how do I know? The material that comes out of their mouths, their lips, is modern Vedas. It is, if you like, the latest version of spirituality. It is original. Every time. Look at the teaching of Vivekananda. He will, of course, once in a while quote the Bhagavad Gita, just to show that it's not really that different. But he will produce modern Gita. People say, no, Mr. Lakhani, you must look at the Bhagavad Gita. I said, why? You got a modern guy who's giving you latest Gita. This idea of the way I suss them out is the originality of the way they present the idea of spirit. Never falling back on the Bhagavad Gita or the Puran. No. They produce new stuff from their lips. And that will give the thrill of the... If you're serious, again, look, let me not vilify humanity. Human beings will progress at their own pace. So depending on the level of growth they have, they will latch on to that kind of a teacher, a guru. We can't blame them. So if your level is very superficial, you just want external, you're not that serious about religion. You just want somewhere to go on Sundays. So let's go to the temple. And that is your level, good for you. So you're going to just stay there. You won't progress. But so be it. It's not, I'm not vilifying them, how horrible people. They should grow up out of sectarian movements and think about great personalities of Vivekananda. No, I'm simply saying that is their level of growth. Let them grow from there. When they mature, they think deeper about religion, they will move away or move on, I should say. So be it. The religion that we come from is so magnanimous. It allows everybody to progress spiritually from where they are, not where we are, and at the pace that suits their own temperament. Don't say rush it. They might want to go slowly. You know, why rush? Why force them? This is the beauty of Hinduism. It's magnanimous, but it gets taken for a ride. And that's tremendous. I feel, when I look at some of these programs and I see these devout Hindus, you know, worshipping somebody I know with a charlatan, I go, oh, I shudder. I feel for those poor people. The little bit of savings gone. And they've been cheated. And it's terrible. But this happens in the name of religion in modern India, without any doubt.